Good morning and welcome on this live safari. My name is Brent. I have VM on camera with me, Scotty and Brian on the other vehicle, and we have Nikki, whose birthday it is today. Happy birthday, Nikki, and Tara and Eugene and Jandre in final control. So as you can see, we've started our morning off at the hyena den. Unfortunately, the little guy's not there, but mom is here, so we're definitely gonna hang around to see what happens in the next couple of minutes. Hopefully the little guy decides to come out. Might be a little bit chilly for him just yet. So if you are new, welcome. We are on a live safari. You are looking at a female hyena lying in the entrance to her den site at the exact same time we are. And we also are interactive, so you can ask us questions about what we're seeing. And you can do that by emailing us. And the email address is questions@wildearth.tv. Or you can use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So the reason we came to the den first off this morning is I was hoping it would be more active. Hyena dens generally are a little bit more active when it's cool. Oh, she heard something. Possibly another hyena coming back, or with their ears she can hear stuff that's miles and miles away compared to what we can. And obviously not that interesting, whatever she heard. As you can see, just by looking around, we're in the height of our dry season. And you can see there's very little grass around. A lot of the trees don't have any leaves. And I really love this time of the year. And amazing colors in the sky. And created by a lot of the dust that's disturbed by all the animals. So at the moment, we're pretty confident there's one very young hyena in there, and that's why mom is guarding the gate, so to speak. And while the hyena is this age, I mean probably under a month old at the moment, she is really going to be spending a lot of time here, and so she will only do short stints away foraging and feeding before rushing back to make sure the little one is well nourished. Hyenas are particularly good mothers, very attentive, and unlike other predators, they will suckle their young for much longer normally. So it's not uncommon to see a hyena over a year old still suckling. Who knows, that little one could be just inside the den there suckling. We wouldn't be able to see. So hyenas are, like most predators, they do spend a lot of time resting, but nearly not able to get warmer, a lot more distance in a day than a lion or a leopard does. And that's partly to do with their scavenging. They will patrol huge areas in search of food and, And so they don't spend as much time sleeping as lion and leopard, but I'm pretty sure they still can do a good 12, 13 hours. Come on, little guy, come say hello. So if we have a look at the spotted hyena's ears, like nice radar dishes, and because she's not doing much and there's not much happening, I'm going to ask you guys a quiz. And it's specifically to do with hyena's ears. Who can tell me what is the difference between a spotted hyena's ears and a brown hyena's ears? And you can send your answers to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. What is the difference between a spotted hyena's ears and a brown hyena's ears? And you can see she's got quite tattery ears, and a lot of that is from biting flies, that as it gets warms up during the day, they're gonna start biting, and you can actually see them buzzing around the animals quite often during the day here. So we're not going to move, we're going to sit here for a little bit longer and hopefully we get the little guy coming out. So if it does, we will let you know immediately. But in the meantime, we're going to go across to Scotty, who's after a predator of a different kind. And sorry about that. We've had some gremlins on the other side. Scotty's tracking in a drainage line. Sorry about that. A bit of confusion, yeah, but we are live and we are in the bush, and that does come with certain difficulties that are sometimes unavoidable. But Scotty's back, so we're gonna sit here and wait, hopefully, for that little hyena cub to come out. In the meantime, we're gonna cross across to Scotty, who's tracking a different type of predator. And welcome, so Scott and Brian on camera. We are searching for their Styx pride of lion. We had some of their tracks heading into a riverbed behind us, and it's very thick in there. So what we've done is we've looped around and are hopefully going to either find their tracks coming out onto this road ahead of us. If they don't, we know that they are in the riverbed, so we'll have to take a closer look in there. But first off, we shall continue and see what's happening. Their cubs are moving with the lioness, and it looks like there's also tracks of some of the males with them. So we could potentially see four adult lioness, two big males, and three tiny little cubs. And I haven't seen them for a few days now, and really hope that we may find them. Glad that you got off to a good start with Brent at the hyena den. And we really have been blessed with some incredible game viewing over the last week or so. I wonder if they've managed to catch any prey and have then collected the cubs and taking them to it. It'll be wonderful to see. They could have potentially caught something big. There's two big males with them, and with that added strength, they could have possibly brought down a large item of prey. Okay. I think we are in luck. We are in luck. And look over my right shoulder, you'll see some tracks. It looks like it is just of a male lion. And if you, oh, there we go. It's difficult to see in the flat light, but you can make out over here one lion track. The toes are in the front over there, and the pad is at the back. It looks like, though, just one big male, so he's potentially left the other members of that Styx pride. But let's continue and see where these tracks take us. I did definitely have tracks of the lioness with their cubs heading into the riverbed, which is to our right. But it looks like the male may have left them and continued. There were two males, so they've potentially both moved off, or maybe just one of them. They're not always together. I can see there are definitely both the males, it looks like, at this stage walking down this road. I had tracks on either side. So both males, it looks like, have moved off.
let's continue following up on them. We can always come back a little bit later and see if there's any sign of the lioness and the cubs. Message from Brent, who's been listening to the Game Drive channel, and he says that the entire pride of lion that we are tracking now, both the two Matimba males and the four sticks lioness with the cubs, are all on a buffalo kill, but sadly not on our property. So all these tracks are from last night, but the lions have moved a long distance and been successful, which is great news. The lioness are hungry and they've got those three little cubs to feed. So good prospects for the pride, but not good prospects for us, because we're not going to be able to see them. So what we'll do is just continue following these tracks, and even though we know that they've ended up a fair distance from here, we're not sure what else we may bump into along the way. And this route will take us up towards Buffalo's Hook Dam, which is a good place to search for any potential animals, not only the lion to look for Archer. There's also a lot of other animals, so we mustn't be disappointed hugely that the lion have gone, because it allows us to look for and look at some other animals. Not only animals but also scenery, and I'm just going to try and find a little gap here. There's some beautiful clouds and colors.
A cheetah and wild dog on site to protect the impala and the zebra and the other grazing species. And amazing how in such a short time our perceptions have completely changed. Also, the reason brown hyena have sort of slowly been pushed out of these areas, they do occur quite close to here though, is due to water holes. So in the Kruger, a lot of dams and water holes were pumped. They are busy trying to rectify this now. They're closing down a lot of that. And what happened is, by putting water permanently in areas where there was only water during the wet season, it enabled spotted hyenas to colonize these dry areas where they wouldn't have been traditionally, and they would have only been seasonally. And basically in that, they outcompete the brown hyenas and have actually moved them out of vast areas of the lowveld. But there are still quite a lot of brown hyena around. They're just much, much sneakier. Probably not in this area. We've got too many spotted hyenas. But in other areas, definitely still brown hyena. Not very far from here as well. Good morning, Lucy in Indiana. Lucy would like to know, with that really small hyena cub in the den at the moment, do the other sort of sub-adults have to stay outside, or do they use a different hole? You'll probably find they use a different hole, but they are at the age where they will go out foraging with the other adults, so that is also possible. They might be inside or they might be away. So there we go, the difference between a spotted hyena like the one we're looking at there and a brown hyena. You can see that very, very different looking. Brown hyena's got this very long shaggy coat, but also similar build, obviously quite a bit smaller than the spotted hyena. A big spotted hyena can be about 80 kilograms, and there's a really big brown hyena, probably not more than 60. And you can see those very pointy ears, sort of shaggy mane. They are funny looking creatures. And dark chocolate brown hair. So guys, it doesn't look like we're going to get any joy here. We can possibly come check a little bit later, but very quiet here. So we're going to head on. Oh no! How's that? Perfect timing. Look who's popped up. A little bit of patience pays off. So he's probably been lying just there out of sight. As you can see, got an itchy chin. Probably quite a few fleas around. And that is a big problem. For hyena in these dens, and that's the reason they move dens quite frequently, and that's to avoid all the ectoparasites, so like fleas and ticks and mites and other itchy bitey things. Hi, Sandy from Indiana. Welcome on the Sunrise Safari, Sandy. Sandy would like to know, or just letting me know, that a few years ago, a brown hyena was actually seen on drive, very, very briefly, for about 30 seconds, and never again since. Thanks very much, Sandy. Can you let me know whether that was actually on Djuma or on Thornybush? I'd be really interested to know. Which reserve the brown hyena was spotted on, and I would really, really appreciate that. I've seen brown hyena in this area, or in the Lowveld itself, probably 20 or 30 times, but in the greater Kruger, I've only seen them twice. One second, sorry guys, I'm just gonna try roll back a little bit to see if we can see a bit more of what's going on there, the den mouth. So you can see he's got that really dark black coat as a baby, and slowly that coat will just change color and become lighter, and you'll start seeing the spots come through in a few months. Here you go, Mom doing a bit of grooming. Wasn't that perfect timing, as we decided it was time to possibly go leave. After sitting here for quite a while, the little guy decided time to come out and play. So he's still tiny, 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 and you can see he's got some scars on his body still, or her body. And those scars are probably from killing its sibling in the den at birth. So just after birth, if two males or two females are born, the firstborn will practice what's called siblicide, or Cain and Abel syndrome, and they'll actually kill the other member, and this only happens if they're of the same sex. So if there's a male and female born, they won't do it. And the reason they do this is because both, if they're both females, they'll both be competing for the exact same spot in the clan. What are you doing there? Chewing a little root. Benjamin, who's contacting us via email on this sunrise safari. Benjamin would like to know, is the art wolf related to hyena? Yes, but very loosely, Benjamin. They share a common ancestor a very long time ago, but they've obviously diverged quite a lot since then. And the obviously, you can see that in their diets. Art wolf's diet is almost exclusively termites. Where obviously the hyenas, be it spotted, striped, or brown, most definitely meat eaters. So quite interesting. I'm sure quite a few of you are wondering, what is the average time between litters? So how long before this female would possibly have another set of cubs or another cub? And in the research that I've read up on in the greater Kruger area, it's a bit longer than other places, and it's 16 months is the average between litters. but in East Africa, it can be as short as 12 months, but normally around 14. When they're born, these little guys weigh only 1.5 kilograms, so size of a sort of very small dog, like a Jack Russell, or even Jack Russell might be a bit heavier than that. But when they're born, 1.5 kilograms. So like we were chatting about yesterday on the Sunset Safari, we were chatting about instinct versus teaching with a lot of predator cubs. Hyena cubs also, 90% of their hunting instincts are they're born with, and they will obviously develop those over time, and certain hyenas in certain areas specialize in different things. Like I've seen, in East Africa, in the Serengeti and Masai Mara, hyenas will actually actively sniff out young topi that are left in the grass. In northern Botswana, I've seen hyena clans that actively hunt big herds of buffalo, and even I've seen them even take down an adult hippo. So a lot of that is instinctive, but they do definitely learn special skills depending on where they are and what prey is available. So obviously in this area, they do quite a lot of their own hunting, but also they are expert scavengers in this area because of the large number of lions and leopards around. So they do a lot of scavenging, but they also do a lot of their own hunting. Not far from here, I've actually seen, which is, I'm not sure how common this is and how many times it's been recorded. I saw a hyena cub probably about 3 months at that stage, even a little bit younger, maybe 2.5 months. And so definitely not at the stage where they're actively eating meat yet. Mother hyena had caught a baby duiker, and it brought that duiker intact back to the den, and the cub didn't really know what to do with it. It was playing with it, and mother just kept nuzzling it towards it. So there was quite an interesting thing. It was a new mother. She was quite a young hyena, so very interesting. And she was at the den by herself when another hyena that, what was that? I heard something. Just a bird scratching around. When another hyena arrived, who was obviously more dominant than her in the clan, she immediately just went and sort of inhaled that baby duiker. But that's the first time I've ever seen them bring a full carcass like that to a cub before feeding on it and trying to get the cub to feed on it, even though it was a bit too young. So maybe there is an element, but 90% of it would be instinctual. So we're going to sit here for a bit longer. Hopefully this little guy decides to get a little bit braver and explore a bit further from mom. But in the meantime, we're going to cross across to Scotty, who's got an incredibly beautiful scene to show you, and we'll be back a little later.
Welcome back, everyone. And it's an absolutely beautiful, beautiful sight here at Buffalo's Hook Dam. We've got an Egyptian goose flying overhead. And look at that for a beautiful scene. I heard the hyena cub has popped up, and so is the sun, so it appears things are picking up here on Safari Live, and the Egyptian goose is also getting involved in all the action. And what a beautiful, beautiful morning this is. It's a bit difficult for Brian to follow the goose behind the vehicle. He's limited by the tripod and the antenna behind us. That's why he did stop following it, if you were wondering why. We haven't had any further tracks or signs of anything that we would usually track down, lion or leopard or wild dog. But we haven't moved too far since we last saw you. And I've just been waiting here patiently, enjoying the beautiful sunrise and also listening for any potential clues that the animals here could call out to us, notifying us of potential predators, or of the animals themselves. We haven't heard any elephants feeding or trumpeting. So it's safe to say everything is quiet in this area or there's not too much around. So we will continue keeping a close look for any potential action. But couldn't help share this beautiful scene with you. I hope you all enjoyed that scene, and we're going to send you back to Brent and the hyena den site. So happy that the cub has popped out. It's so cute, and we were just talking about it last night, and I believe Brent's also been chatting a little bit about their instincts and how they'll grow up and what we can expect to see from this little cub over the coming months. And it really is an interesting animal, the hyena. So enjoy, and we'll see you all a little bit later.
Welcome back, everyone. VM, we're not going to get an opportunity like this very often. Right in front of us is an orange-breasted bushrike. Oh, he's flying. It's landed just next to the hyena den. An incredibly beautiful bird. I have tried to show you this, guys, before, but it's not often. It's because we're sitting still here that it's hopping around near us. Come on, turn to face us again. Behind the tree. Oh, such a beautiful bird. There he is, popping up again. Might come back towards us. So they can be very shy and retiring, and you can see they move quite quickly, which makes them incredibly difficult to actually get on camera. And you see that little flash of orange there? There's the breast. Oh, a little bit lower. There we go. Oh, you can see how beautiful this bird is. Orange-breasted bushrike is not something we see too often. And well, we do see them and we hear them all the time, but getting it on camera is actually really, really special. And we've got another visitor as well who's arrived. Oh no, where are you going now? At then, and it's one of the hyena cubs who's at hub stealing age, and I think he was sleeping in the burrow on the other side and just popped up around the den right now. Looks like it might try a sneak approach from behind after our hubs. Wasn't that fantastic to see that orange-breasted bushrike? We don't really get to see the bushrikes too often. They are very skulking, and so great to be able to see that. Unfortunately, the little guy has, since you left us, so she's got her body towards us and we can't see the little guy anymore. So, really nice to see that orange-breasted bush shark. Oh! Mom's standing up. And going only leaving her bottom out of the den at the moment. Yeah, watch out for that other little guy. Doesn't just sneak up behind us, which is exactly what he's doing. He's directly behind Vim, and trying to approach our hubs. Morning, wild dog pup. We haven't had a question from you in a while. Nice to hear from you again. Welcome on the Sunrise Safari. Wild dog pup, would like to know, can a newborn hyena tell the sex of its sibling? Most definitely. That's why they practice siblicide and will kill the sibling if it is of the same sex. So they can definitely tell the sex, and they can tell that at birth. How? I'm not sure. Probably a bit of smell. Mom's popped her head out again. Still can't see the little guy. Hi, Marianne. Marianne is contacting her via the Twitter sphere. Marianne would like to know, how old is a hyena cub when it kills its littermate? And are their eyes open when they are born? So, Marianne, quite interestingly, opposed to sort of lions and leopards whose babies are born completely blind, hyena babies are born at a slightly more advanced stage than the other predators, and their eyes are open when they are born. And here comes the hubcap thief, or attempted hubcap thief. So their eyes are open when they are born, and they are born at a slightly more advanced phase than the other predators, and they will kill the sibling within probably an hour or so of birth. I'm watching you. Don't you come near my hubs. It's a long way to Hoedspruit to fetch more. I'm watching you. Where are you, little sneaky? I can see the shadow. I'll watch the shadow. Yeah, see, noisy. Morning, Marianne in Boston. I wonder if you are a Bruins fan, Marianne. Well, Marianne would like to know, what is that bird calling in the background or alarming in the background? Is it that orange-breasted bushrike we just saw? No, Marianne, that is a crested Franklin. He's not alarming. He's just shouting for the joy of the morning. Good morning, Matt from the Lone Star State. Matt would like to know, which of the large predators between lions and hyenas are the best mothers? Well, Matt, it's different because they have different sort of social structures and strategies. But if we had to take it on cub survival, hyenas are probably by far the best mothers. And that's because of the utilization of a den and It's very difficult and very tight in there. A female hyena will battle to get in there, let alone a lion, which is physically a lot bigger. So there is safety in the den for the cubs. So you would probably say hyenas are the better mothers. And they also nurse for much longer, and they're sort of more proactive parents. Once lion cubs get to a certain age, they're sort of just with the pride and left to their own devices. There we go. That is what you call sufficiently scolded. So it's probably not that this other young hyena here has any ill intent towards the little one. It's just that it probably might be a little bit boisterous in playing with it. So the mother is keeping it away from it, and that's why she chased it off. And you heard all that high-pitched giggling, and that was just to sort of say it was a bit of a submissive display, that giggling and whatnot. So I'm sorry, I won't do it again. But of course, being a little hyena, it'll probably do it again about 12 times today. Hi, Lauren from the Great Lake Districts in Michigan. Oh, there we go. Little one popped his head up for a second. Lauren, we'll get to your question in a second. We're just going to see how this pans out. I think there might be another scolding coming up shortly. You can see how ginger... Oh. Lauren would like to know who would win in a standoff between an adult leopard and a hyena. Generally, Lauren, the hyena would win. Oh, go up to the adult. Looked like she might be trying to pick up the cub there. She tried to grab it around the scruff of the neck. Almost thought she might be getting ready to move it to another den. Maybe just moving it out of the way. So Lauren, to go a little bit more in depth on your question there, hyenas are far more adept at sort of fighting and whatnot with a leopard, and being a clan animal, there is a possibility that they're able to survive from food that the clan provides, whether it's a leopard being solitary, to risk fighting with something like a hyena and getting injured, it could mean the end of that animal. So it's more than likely that the leopard, 9 times out of 10, will actually stand down from a hyena. I have seen the hyena would win. Obviously there are circumstances when that is not true. Let me try. Okay. Sufficiently scalded. Hello, and Nikki from Austin, Texas. It seems the Lone Star State is up and about this morning on the Sunrise Safari. Oh, it's going to chase the Franklin for the sake of chasing Franklin by the looks of things. There we go, the Franklin is now sufficiently chased. Very half-hearted attempt. after being scolded, I think he was looking for something else to scold. So Nikki would like to know, how often do they move these dens, and would that be quite a rare occurrence for us to see? It would be a very rare occurrence for us to actually witness, but they do move these dens depending on the ticks and or more on the fleas. They can move them as frequently as once every couple of weeks, but normally it's about once a month or once a month and a half that they will move. But to actually see a mother physically carry a baby to another den site would be a really incredible sighting. I've only ever seen it once before. I think it's coming back for the, trying to sneak in for the hubs again. And the moving of the den could take place either during the day or at night, whenever the hyenas feel the need to move. Good morning, Harry from California. Welcome on the Sunrise Safari. Harry has got quite an interesting question. He'd like to know whether hyena cubs, or siblicide in hyenas, would it occur with only that litter, or would an older cub from a previous litter commit siblicide as well on the younger one? Strangely enough, it is only of the litter that are born together. So what happens with the older cub, let's just use the high rank. Thinking female, so let's say the matriarch, the female who is in charge of the whole clan. It's much easier to just explain with her litters. So that cub, say her firstborn cub, will immediately become second in command. And if she was to die, while that second cub was an adult, that second cub would immediately fall into the matriarchal sort of role. So if her second litter is two females, siblicide would happen between those two females born at the same time. And what would happen then is that the one would kill the other, and then the surviving one would then become the third ranking, and so on and so forth. So that matriarchal line is actually passed down from mother to daughter. So they do not commit siblicide outside of their own litter. It would have to be the litter they were born in. Where did it go? I can't see it. Had a slight moment there. Thief had gone. What a fantastic way to start the Sunrise Safari with one of my favorite animals, spotted hyena. Morning, Michelle, from the Great Lakes around Massachusetts. Oh no, sorry, from Boston. I'm getting confused there. Michelle would like me to clarify this sub-adult cub that's wandering around terrorizing or trying to terrorize our vehicle. Would this be one of the ones that was born while Tara was presenting? Quite possibly. When I arrived, an interview, when was that, February, there were three little guys, probably about just around a month, month and a bit old then, and they are the, definitely Tara was presenting at that stage, so this would be one of the ones that was here while Tara was presenting. One of the small, small ones. Really still, still morning. Just keeping quiet for a second, see if we could hear any alarm calls or whatnot. Good morning, Miss Chin from Dallas, Texas. Ms. Tim would like to know, what is the number one killer of hyena cubs? More than likely, it is lions. Lions are definitely the number one killer of hyena cubs. And it's normally when they're about this age that they start meandering with the adults. That is when they become targets. So if the hyenas are out foraging, and at this age they often go with, and obviously they're not quite as fast and as adept as the adults at getting out of the way of lions. Well guys, we've had such a great start here. There are other vehicles that are wanting to come into the sighting, so we've had it all to ourselves. So I think it's time we're gonna head on and leave the hubcap thief and the latest edition with its mom. And the little guy's gone back into the den, and I think is suckling just from the way mom's seeing, and we're not going to be able to get a visual of that. So I think it's time to head out and see what else we can find. Thank you very much to Pat, Connie, Sharon and John, who have confirmed that that brown hyena sighting was actually Peter Pretorius Rexon, and it was in May 2009 and it was on Djuma. Well, there's a challenge. Hey, Wildebeest, let's go find a brown hyena. Wow, I'd be so excited if we found a brown hyena. Leaving the Munificaya still active. From Abony, Scotland. Ron, we had a little chat with Ron a few days ago about his upcoming trip to South Africa and to the Kruger, as well as to Namibia and Zimbabwe. Ron is staying around the Palabora area of the park, and he would like to know where is the best place to look for brown hyena, to the north and east in the sandbelt. Well, Ron, you're spot on. The best place would be anything north of Mapani, towards Punda Maria, in that scrub Mapani belt. That would be the best place to look for brown hyena. Unfortunately, they are very nocturnal, and obviously, and we are, as a normal person in the park, you're unable to drive at night with a spotlight. But if you go on one of the park drives, probably from that area, there's always a chance. A very small chance, but nevertheless a chance.
Scott.
Scotty, what area are you at the moment? Copy, thank you. I'm going to check around tree house in that area.
So, Scotty's on the trail of something, so while we go look for something to, something out here, or something to track, we're going to cross across to Scotty, and nice early morning tracking, so hopefully he has some luck with those tracks, and we'll be back with you a little later.
Welcome back everyone, and good to hear that the hyena cubs have been really playful and inquisitive this morning, so it sounds like you've been having a great time there. As you can see, I'm off the vehicle. A leopard has been moving in this general direction towards us, and we looped around to see if the tracks would come out of the block, and basically it would have walked along this pathway, and then the tracks have continued down to just in front of me here. It looks like a female. It could be a young male, so I'm a little bit unsure. But here you can see the tracks, the toes in the front, and the pad at the back heading in that direction. So it is in the direction. And the dam where we've just been at. So we're going to head back there. I think what could have happened is that this leopard may have come down in the course of the evening and had a drink in the one corner of the dam, but we are going to still continue to track it and see where it's ended up. Who knows, maybe it's made a kill nearby, even though we do seem to be a little bit behind. It's really difficult to establish how fresh tracks are, whether they're from early last night or late last night. But certainly still worth following up on. It's warming up into a beautiful day now. As earlier it was freezing, Brian was saying it was difficult to control the camera and all the different buttons with his frozen fingertips. So that's something to bear in mind on for us on the colder mornings. John in California, good morning and good to have you with us. John has asked a very interesting question about lion dynamics and what would possibly happen if the Styx pride with their three little cubs, as well as the two Matimba males that are currently with them, if they came across the Inkahuma pride of eight lions, what would happen? Would the Matimba males take sides? Would they not get involved? I actually don't know what would unfold. It would be very interesting to see. Technically, it should be a fight between the Styx lioness and the Inkahuma pride, and their lioness, the young male in the Inkahuma pride, may get involved because he is still part of that pride and yet to form his own coalition. Because it's usually a female on female battle with lions and a male on male battle. So that's why I'm less inclined to think that they would get involved, but who knows, possibly because there are young cubs that they have sired with the Styx pride, they may kind of lean towards helping
that pride, there's also less lioness in that pride, so another reason why they could potentially feel obliged to help the lesser team. But I'm not sure what would happen, and I guess we would only way we would find out for certain is if we saw it, because on past examples with different prides and similar scenarios, males may have joined in the fight on some occasions and not in the others. I'm fairly certain that has been the case.
Good question though, John, and an interesting thought or scenario to play out. But like I say, it's only watching these events unfold that we will know the outcome of them. We can hypothesize as much as we like about what we think they might do, but so often the animals will prove us wrong. So the leopard tracks, I'm guessing, continued on the northern side of the dam, which is the opposite side of the dam to where we are now. But we have to go along this way because this is the only road available to us. So we're just going to loop around, and I'm guessing we're going to find the tracks coming out on Buffalo's Hook Dam West Road. We've got a good idea of the general direction that the leopard has been moving in, and that's what... Stick around, it's a beautiful that will glow in the morning sunshine. Sorry for the little jump in picture there, it was a little dip that I went through further back. I should have warned you, apologies. My brain is still warming up this morning. It was an Egyptian goose that we saw earlier that you heard earlier. And it was a virtual starling that we got a glimpse of earlier just as the signal dipped. I was hoping it was going to stick around, but it flew off, so you didn't miss anything there. Some of you may have wondered what this massive pile of dung may have been caused by. And as you can see, it's not only this dung close to me here, but also this whole pile that's been kicked and scattered about. And I'm just going to jump out quickly and, sorry, Brian, and show you exactly what happens here. So these, as you can see, are the individual big balls of dung that are dropped out. And what will happen is they will often defecate in this area like this, and then they will proceed to kick and drag their feet to get the scent onto their feet, and that's why there's this massive pile built up behind you. And the animal responsible for this is the white rhino. Now you may be wondering why you haven't ever been shown them by us, because they're big animals and relatively easy to find. But sadly, rhino are under huge attack from poachers. The trade for rhino horn is in huge demand. And hundreds of rhino have already been killed this year in South Africa. And it really is a sad, sad topic. And that's why we don't show them. We don't want to be in any way linked to any rhino that are poached. And because people can gain intelligence from where the rhino are by watching the show, even though it's very unlikely, we don't want to run that risk. So that is the reason why we don't show you white rhino. But they do occur here. And that is who is responsible for that massive pile of dung you can see. It's called the midden, and often different herbivores and also some carnivores will defecate in certain positions so that they become information hotspots. It almost becomes like an internet cafe where people can come in
and gain access to intelligence within their own species. So with the herbivores, like I say, it's called the midden, and that's derived from a Dutch word. So the Dutch viewers may know a midem as a haystack. So that's where the word originates from. And you also get impala middens and certain other herbivores defecating in certain spots to communicate. And for carnivores, it would be called the latrine. And civets will defecate in certain areas, as one example. Other carnivore, well, I guess it is omnivorous, that defecates in certain spots. So they can leave messages all over the roads and areas that they move, and that way not necessarily see one another and come into contact with one another, but still be able to know who's in the area, if any females are single and looking for love. These kinds of messages get left behind. Forgot about the leopard we are tracking. Let's see if there's no tracks coming out on this road network, because they should have in all likelihood come through here. They were heading in this general direction up from the dam. Well, no luck, so I wonder where this leopard's hiding. We're going to continue to work this area, as it could be nearby. The tracks did appear fresh. So it might be worth hanging around here a bit longer. Maybe we'll hear some alarm calls. Possibly walking down the road straight towards us. That's also a possibility. Sounds like I'm not the only person tracking a leopard this morning. Brent's also got onto some fresh tracks, and it's of, in all likelihood, Shadow, a female leopard with a young male cub, so exciting prospects there, and we're going to send you over to him to let you know how his tracking is going. We'll keep you all updated on how we do here.
Welcome back, everyone. So I hope you had some fun with Scott. We are currently in, so I'm hoping that we find some fresh tracks from this morning. If not, we're going to keep meandering down towards the Arethusa waterhole and then move our way around. The last tracks were seen up to the north of us here, heading south. So I'm just trying to find if there are any tracks crossing the road. So Shadow really likes this area. There's quite a lot of little drainage lines and that's quite a good area for it to hunt. Lots of cover. Gilly from Milwaukee. Gilly is looking for an update on the wild dogs, the pregnant females that we've seen. The large pack, the half-tail pack, has denned in a property quite far south of us. They do occasionally meander up this way while hunting, but it's not likely we're going to see too much of them for the next while. And the second pack the pack of five. No one has seen them for quite some time. The last time they were seen was in central Manuleti, so it's quite a strong likelihood they've denned in the Manuleti. So unfortunately, no dogs around for us. They might come through the area hunting like they did yesterday. We've had a report of the tracks, but they literally skimmed through our eastern, southeastern corner and were gone. Howard, the hyena tracks. So, I got excited for a second, thought we'd find some leopard tracks. Good morning, Edward. Welcome on the Sunrise Safari. Edward would like to know, when hyenas hunt for themselves, do they tear into prey like wild dogs, or do they first wait for them to die? Unfortunately, Edward, nature is quite brutal, and none of the predators will actually wait for them to die if there's more than one present. They will start feeding on the animals while they're alive, be it hyena, lion, leopard, wild dog. They will all start feeding while an animal can be alive, so sometimes quite hard to watch, but it is nature taking its course. And those prey species by that stage are in a serious state of shock, so it's unlikely that they are feeling much then. Come on, Shadow, where are you hiding? It is an absolutely stunning morning. I love the soft morning light. And as I said earlier, I do like the bush at this time of the year. So you can see the grass is down, so our visibility is better, so it gives us a better chance to spot things. The smells at this time of the year, you can smell the dust. Can be a little bit irritating sometimes, but I like it. And also the colors that you get in the sky, and you can actually, let me stop for a second so you can see. You can actually see the sort of dust and smoke level at this time of the year. If we start on the horizon and then go up, you can actually see that sort of layer of dust that's sitting in the atmosphere. And then as you go higher, it gets bluer, more blue. Always good to stop and listen every now and then, if we pick up any alarm calls. And you can see how blue the sky is above that sort of layer of dust. Thanks, Fim. And I can even deal with the cold at this time of the year because generally the game viewing is so fantastic. So while we are meandering around, we've had a look at these a few times before, but I'm going to see who can figure out what did this. Very, very interesting little thing. Now, this is a different type of to the ones we've seen before. Very, very interesting. So you can tell me what did that, or what little chocho or insect did that. I'll let you know it is in a terminalia or a silver cluster leaf. I'll keep that there for just now. So it is in a silver custody, which is this tree up to the right here. And this one is particularly has been actually pushed down by elephants on the ground next to us here. So what insect would have caused a tree to form something like that? I got a feeling we're going to find tracks on this junction. Junctions are really important places to start looking for tracks. Unfortunately, I was wrong. There are tracks, but not the tracks we're looking for. Approaching the Arethusa waterhole, so we'll have a quick look. What is happening around the water? Oh, another nice good junction. Always good to I think it's time for a little track test. Let's see if you guys have been concentrating on all the tracks that Scott and James and myself have been showing you. So we're going to put your knowledge to the test now. One of the most important things when you're doing a track test is you need the correct stick. This will do. So we'll start with track number one. Close the door. A very big track. I'm just going to get my binoculars out so you can reference size. Track number one is a very big track. You can see it is longer than my binoculars. So a really, really big track of a definitely a hooved animal. And let's have a look for track number two. Oh, let's go with a little smaller track here. And we'll do one more. Can hear hippos behind us at the Arethusa waterhole. Have a look. Ooh. You see this one here, Jim?
I think it's a bit far.
Bit far. Okay, let's find one a bit closer. Let me move the vehicle. It'll be a bit easier. So you've got to, I'm going to give you three tracks to identify. See if you can see it nicely from... How's this here? And there is track number three. And binoculars. There we go. That's three tracks. I expect 100% from everyone. Otherwise, I'll come after you with my tracking stick. Okay, let's go have a look what's been happening at the Arethusa. Oh no. George from sunny Florida. George would like to know, do wild dogs and hyenas Yes, George, and probably more so than most other predators. Hyenas have learned that wild dogs are very successful hunters, and they will often trail a herd of wild dogs knowing they're going to get scraps at the end. And wild dogs have developed quite an aggressive stance towards hyena and will actively attack them and bite their rumps. And you'll often see a hyena, let me show you what a hyena does when it's attacked by a wild dog. So obviously the soft part of hyena is its bottom. So before we go have a look at the hippos and whatnot, I'll show you exactly where the bush. I'm not going to do it in the same type of bush as a hyena because I'm not that brave. Where's a good bush? So you can imagine wild dogs are really, really fast. So they run around, and one wild dog will try to bite will snap around the face of the hyena, and then the others will run around and bite him on the rump. So what hyenas have developed and what they do when they are attacked by wild dogs like this is they look for the biggest, thorniest bush possible, and then they do this. So imagine I'm a hyena, I'm being harassed by wild dogs incessantly. So one will be coming around trying to nip me, and I'm trying to get my bum out of the way while the wild dogs are coming off me. So I'm going to get there, and I find a thorn bush, and I put my bum in it. So I've got lots of thorns behind me to protect me, and then I can defend myself against the wild dogs as they come and snip at me. And hyenas will squeal, and you can see them put their bums in the biggest, thorniest acacia possible to protect their behinds from the wild dogs. So obviously, a thorn bush will hurt a little bit, but being nipped by a wild dog hurts a lot more. It's very seldom that these confrontations actually get into real physical danger for either animal. They sort of have an agreement that the wild dogs will nip, and chase the hyenas away, and the hyenas will keep coming to try to steal their food. Okay, so the clown session of the game drive is over. Well, now I'll be very serious and scientific for the rest. Of course, I wasn't going to do what the hyena does and find a big thorny acacia. I went for a nice soft quarry. I think I would have been squealing and like a hyena if I had put my bottom into a very thorny acacia. Okay, well, we've got some hippopotami. So, for anyone who might be slightly confused why I was running around and putting my bottom in a bush, we got a question about how hyenas and wild dogs interact, and I was showing what hyena does when chased and nipped by wild dogs. But if you are a bit late and have just sighed in, we spent quite a bit of time at the hyena den this morning, and we got to see some interaction between the adult female and her tiny cub, as well as one of the sub-adult cubs. Here we go, hippopotami. In front of Arethusa Lodge. And if you're wondering how to ask us questions, you can send us an email via questions@wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So just to let everyone know what Scotty is up to, he has been tracking a female leopard for the majority of the morning, but obviously, touch wood, I never have to do such things, such menial tasks as change tyres. Little guy catching a lift. So Scotty's busy changing a tyre. He's at a flat, and we'll check in with him as soon as he's managed to fix that. There we can see two youngish ones climbing on each other and just having a bit of fun this morning. They are two both little guys, so maybe just a little bit of playing. Oh, there we go. It's called to drown the other. So hippos are quite fascinating beasts, even though most of the time we see them there in the water or lazing on a sandbank. And they can be very active, and they can move up to 30 kilometers in an evening to feed, specifically and especially in the dry season, because the grass gets more scarce. And oh, there you go. Very boisterous this morning. And even though they might not look it, they are incredibly fast. A hippo can run probably just under 50 kilometers or between 40 and 50 kilometers an hour. So far faster than a human and for far longer than we can. So if you had to imagine Usain Bolt in a race against the hippo would overtake Usain in about 2 seconds. And that's the fastest man alive. Very peaceful setting here in front of Arethusa Safari Lodge.